Born in Glasgow, he started making music at a very early age, and at 15 was the principal cornet for the 7th Battalion Highland Light Infantry. Later, he graduated in piano, cornet, and French horn. Latterly, while holding his professorship at the Royal Marine School of Music, he's been associated with several leading British bands, most notably, perhaps, the Brighouse and Rastrick Band. Our special correspondent at Southport, John Noble, asked Professor Hargraves, after hearing our A-grade bands, how would they compare with those in Britain?
I suppose it's always a very difficult and dangerous thing to try and make comparisons between any type of organisation. We in Britain, I suppose, have a much, much better chance to be organised, shall we say, because it's so much closer, especially when you can think on a place like Yorkshire, Lancashire, even the Midlands, where you can get within a radius of about 20 miles, you probably get about 50-odd bands. Now, you come to Australia here, of course, 1,000 miles is nothing in Australia, is it? Nothing at all, and therefore they don't get quite the same chance. But so far, the ones that I have heard, the best ones, shall I say, I think could compete quite successfully in England.
Professor, I wonder if I could have your views on the value of band contests in general. This is a subject that's often hotly debated.
Well, now, this is probably, as I think you've said it correctly, it's a very, very debatable subject. Possibly, so many people have great reservations. I too have my reservations, but I honestly think, had it not been for the contest, the brass band movement, as we in it know, and although I'm still more or less outside, I'm inside, if that makes sense to you, I think this must be the reason why the standard of brass playing is probably higher than any other kind of instrumental music, especially when it comes to group playing. We can get an orchestra, and, well, you just sort of take them or leave them. And mind you, this is because of the tremendous difficulty of strings. You can get the same thing with woodwind, where the reeds can cause so much trouble, and therefore you don't get quite the standard. But either of those groups, I think, had they gone into contesting, would have got into deeper detail, and this is why the contesting of the brass band movement is so wonderful. Mm-hmm. Now, the big drawback to that is the fact that it tends to make you stay too long on one piece of music, and this is what most people outside of the brass band object to. Yes. Because when it comes to, shall we say, reading music, then quite a lot of them are, I'm afraid, behind standard when it comes to that sort of thing. Yes, indeed. No doubt about it, when they produce what, shall we say, a finished product, it is certainly worth listening to. There's no doubt whatever about that. And the reading, probably after a while, must improve, provided you've got the man in the middle who thinks intelligently. And this is a big thing to do with the mind, isn't it?
Yes, indeed. Most of the main events this year are being held in a rather large marquee situated at the rear of the RSL Club at Southport. How do you find the acoustics in such surroundings? I imagine there'd be very little reverberation, for instance.
Well, I you know, this is a funny thing now. Coming back to this word reverberation, you've heard, I hope, of the very, very famous Black Dyke Band in England. And the band that I used to conduct, the Brighouse in Rastrick, which is only somewhere in the region of about 7-8 miles away. In Brighouse, we have a band room that is acoustically dead. And because of that, the conductor at that time, when I was conducting, you could miss nothing at all of detailed thing you're speaking about there. Mm. And when they went into what we'll call the normal halls, their sound just seemed to expand and explode. And I honestly feel now this is why the great English bands have such a wonderful sound. But to take it from a contesting angle and from an adjudicating angle, I'm not so very sure that it is a good thing, because I just can't get a chance to catch all the detail that I would really like, because things can go so quickly past you, you know, when you're trying to follow a score like that. But at the same time, I hope I haven't made many mistakes so far. I hope not. I haven't heard of any.
Do you think that bandsmen and the band movement in some ways are a little bit too insular from the rest of the musical fraternity?
Well, I couldn't agree more with that remark. This has been the biggest problem. We've been speaking maybe privately together regarding the choice of a test piece and regarding the fact that we can get arrangements of classical works, such as the Dvorak New World Symphony. Some of Elgar's works have been done. A lot of Wagnerian works have been done. The Gustav Holst Planets, things like this. Now, when you get that, then you've got to get authenticity. You've got to try and capture the colour of an orchestra. Now, any time that I've done this myself personally, I've gone out of my way to bring at least three different recordings into my band room to let the men hear what I am trying to do and to let them get the real sound what the composer intended. Now, when you say that we are completely insular, I do agree. I honestly think that bandsmen should and must, if they want to improve their own musical repertoire and their own musical knowledge and intelligence, listen much more to symphonic playing and even military playing and even choirs to get a breadth of musical knowledge that I'm afraid they're just killing themselves by not so doing.
Professor Walter B. Hargraves, chief adjudicator for the 1976 Australian Brass Band Championships, was talking with John Noble, our acting supervisor of music in Queensland.